I just hit the button, it's gone.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Prayer this morning. We just invite you to Church said, amen. Would you come and give your offering some time? And after that, our children and youth may be dismissed to your classes.
Any good person, when your pastor asks you to do something, what do you do?
Say yes, brother, and I'll do it. I actually am excited about this because it gives me a chance to sort of experiment in a new angle this morning. So hopefully, those of you who heard it, this will be presented in a new way. Those of you who didn't hear it, I'm excited that you're here this morning and we'll be listening to this sermon on planning and expectation. The title of my sermon this morning is Serving with Excellence. Serving with excellence. So many times we do things halfway. Amen? So many times we go through the motions. I get on people all the time that, you know, in my own profession, in my family, in church, in ministry, I say, guys, let's not do this thing halfway. There's an old saying that says, if there's anything that's worth doing, it's worth doing right, worth doing well. And you know, it sort of goes along with the scripture in Colossians chapter 3, verse 17. I'm going to read that one first this morning. In Colossians 3:17, it says, and whatever you do, or whatever you say, do it as a representation of Christ. Everything that you do represents Him. Every word that you speak, every action that you take, represents Him. And if you think that you're living your life passively and no one is watching, you are wrong. Somebody is watching. Most importantly, your family is watching. Your friends, your colleagues, your folks at church, the people that you live with, the people that you hang out with, they're watching your actions. And if Christ is reflected in you, they see that. And I'm going to smile when I say this. If Christ is not reflected in you, they see that more. Now, friends, I hate to say that to you. I hate to be the bearer of bad news. But it don't matter if you've done 99 good things. It's the one thing you didn't do well that always gets amplified. And all God's people said, amen. Bible says to be instant in season and out of season. Always be ready. Always be prepared. Always, Bible says that since you are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, lay aside the sin and the weight that so easily besets you. The sin and the weight. Maybe it is a sin that you need to get out of your life this morning. Maybe it's something you struggled with since you were a child, or since you were a young man or a young woman. Or maybe it's not a sin. Maybe it's just a weight of being stressed all the time, a weight of not having time to study and pray and read God's word, a weight of the world, as we say, on our shoulders. So many times we get stressed in situations. So many times we are stuck in situations or circumstances that we didn't ask for, but God is going to pull you through. But it's how you act in those situations, it's your attitude that determines the outcome. It's how you walk through the process that leads you to the product. I've said so many times, and I'll say it again, thank God for Joseph. Thank God that he didn't falter when his brothers was against him. Notice I said his brothers. His family, people of his own household were against him. The attack started from inside. So many times, the majority of our problems start from the inside. We get attacked from things on the inside, from the inner circle. And maybe it's not intentional. I wouldn't think that anybody's malicious enough to just try to see you fall. Some people are, amen? But so many times, it's people that attack us from the inside. People in our family. Why do you think that the biggest fights happen between a man and a wife on Sunday morning? Some of y'all ain't laughing because you're sitting next to your spouse and y'all was fighting this morning. Uh-huh. I hear you. Why is it, and it never fails, something stressful is going to happen on Sunday morning. Amen? Something. Either your kids that went crazy, or your spouse, and you are bickering with each other, fighting. Why? Because Satan knows that if he can attack you internally, he can get to you externally. He knows. So how do you do? Well, how do you combat that? How do you go against that? Always serve with excellence. Always. Scripture says everything that you do, everything that you say, do it as a representation of Christ, giving thanks through him to God the Father. Whether it's being a representative of Christ in front of our family on Sunday mornings, or whether it's being a representative of Christ in front of our friends and our colleagues on Monday through Saturday, we must represent him well. Thank God for Joseph. Joseph didn't falter in the face of his brothers. And then he didn't falter or fall in the face of Potiphar and Potiphar's wife. And then he stood steady as he interpreted dreams for a butler and a baker. And then he stood strong as he interpreted dreams for a Pharaoh. You see, before you can reach great heights, it starts with your character in your own home. Before you can reach new levels, you must serve with excellence in the level that you're at. God will never place you at another level if you have not served well on the level previously. The Bible says, forsake not small beginnings. We as a church, we as a people, we as individuals, we as a group of believers must serve well. You are planted where God has you right now. Whether it be on the job, the workplace, in your home, whatever situation that you're facing, you are there to show God's glory. You are there to show his mastership. You are there to show that he is God and he alone. Serve with excellence. Don't serve halfway. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. I don't want you to raise your hands. I don't want you to say anything. I'm just going to ask you. On a scale of 1 to 5, how would you rate the cleanliness of your home right now? If somebody were to come into your house right now, would you be happy and say, come on in? Or if they called you and said, I'm going to be there in 10 minutes, would you absolutely go ballistic and say, man, I've got to clean this thing up right now? Now, don't answer that out loud. On a scale of 1 to 5, you will find that most people's homes, and I'm talking about more than 75% of the general population, most people's homes rank somewhere in the mid-range, 3. Now, why you talk about the cleanliness of people's homes? Is that directly related to your spiritual life? Not necessarily, but all too often, it's the same concept. How would you rank the cleanliness of your spiritual life? On a scale of 1 to 5, 1 being the worst, 5 being the best, where is your spiritual life today? Is it a 1? Do you need major improvement? Is it a 5? Are you the Christian that you ought to be? Or are you living in the comfort zone? My friends, nothing wrong with living in the comfort zone in your physical house. That's your physical house, amen? Most people could honestly say, yeah, hey, my house right now, it's pretty clean, but if you're going to come over, give me about 1 to 2 hours, and I'll have it fresh and ready. But that's the problem with spirituality. I'm not talking about your physical home, your spiritual home. We live in the comfort zone, to where when Satan attacks you, you need to go get ready. My friends, you don't have time to get ready when the enemy attacks. You don't have time. Why do we think that it's acceptable to live a mediocre spiritual life? And I'm preaching to the church as a whole, and I'm preaching to Life Church right now. Why do we think that it's okay to live an average, mediocre spiritual life? Why do we think it's okay to have average, mediocre prayer lives? To where when tragedy strikes or a situation comes up in our lives, we have to go get right with God. We should already be right with God, amen? We should be ready to attack the enemy head on. We should be ready for the attacks of the enemy. But instead, we dwell in the comfort zone. We dwell in mediocrity. We live a level 3 lifestyle. My challenge for you this morning is to up your game from a level 3 spiritual walk to a level 5, my friends. If you have somebody coming over to your house for lunch today, I'm sure your house is spotless. If you have somebody, friends or neighbors or family members coming over to celebrate an accomplishment or just to be there to hang out with you, I'm sure your house is spotless. Why is it that we can't prepare our spiritual homes the same way that we prepare our physical homes? Excellence is not just a fancy word. Excellence is the way that you should live your spiritual life every day. Why do ministries falter so much? Because they serve with an attitude of mediocrity. For my ministers in this room, for my people who are leading ministries, and for my families who are leading your homes, are you serving spiritually with an attitude of mediocrity? Or are you serving with the spirit of excellence? How will you choose to live your life today? Let me define what excellence is for you. It is the quality of being outstanding or extremely good at something. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I am not here promoting pride. I am here talking about serving God with excellence. I'm not here to say that you should be trying to impress folks, trying to impress others. I have told you since day one, since I got here over 3 years ago, me and my wife, that the first time you see us trying to put on a show, kick us off stage. It's not about a show with worship. It's about your heart and your attitude. When you walk through those doors of this sanctuary, you better make sure your heart and your attitude is right and ready to worship. So many times we come worship lifestyle, mediocre prayer life, mediocre praise life, mediocre worship life, mediocre reading schedule, mediocre walk with God, and we expect miracles and great things to happen. My friends, we need to serve Christ with diligence, commitment, dedication. We must serve with excellence, not to impress others, but to please God. How many could say this morning that the actions that you take every day are pleasing to God? See, I'm not worried about impressing you. I'm not worried about what you think of me individually. I love you. I care about you. But when it comes to ministry, I want to impress God. I don't want anything in my life, no sin, no weight that so easily besets me to get me off the path of serving my God. I want to make sure that everything I do is prepared and bathed in prayer, and I'm serving up to the standard that God would have me serve. See, church, good enough is not good enough. That should be a challenge for us this morning. Good enough is not good enough. Especially when we're trying to minister to a hurt and dying generation. I have news for you, ladies and gentlemen. We are in the worst times that we have ever seen. No matter where you stand politically, no matter where you stand on whatever it is that you have a stance on, if we're not standing on the Word of God in this generation, we will fade. The church's effectiveness has faded away because of mediocre Christianity. Now, I may not have you shouting the place down this morning, but I want you to know that this is a reality that plagues many churches in America today. The attitude of mediocrity. Jason, why do y'all come in here and practice? Why do y'all prepare? Why do you prepare a sermon? Why do you do all that? Can't we just give it our all at the time and then just know, my friends, it takes preparation. The Bible says to shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Which means, my friend, if you're not preparing, if you're not putting some effort into it, are you really ready for the battle? The United States military is the strongest force on the planet. Can I get an amen on that one? Do you think that they just don't prepare? How do you plan on overcoming your enemy in your life if you don't prepare with God's Word? How do we prepare to see a breakthrough when we're not worshiping at home and praying and serving Christ with excellence? We must come to Him in an attitude of excellence. Planning, expectation. Planning, expectation. Thank God for Joseph. He was ready. Are you? Joseph was ready for the challenges that faced him in his life because he was prepared. Daniel was ready for the lion's den because he faced spiritual battles prior to that. Everybody talks about Daniel in the lion's den, but my friends, read the scripture. Matter of fact, let's read it now. Daniel chapter 6. Before we ever get to a lion's den, there's preparation. In Daniel chapter 5, verse 12, it said that Daniel had an excellent spirit, that he understood. He had the understanding to interpret dreams, to explain riddles, to solve problems, because he constantly stood, or constantly served, with an attitude of excellence. In Daniel chapter 6, verse 3, it said, Daniel distinguished himself above all the others. Distinguished himself. To the king? No. To God. It said that Daniel had lived a life to where his routine was to pray. Is your routine to pray? Are you living to that standard of excellence that God has set? Do you live in a generation to where anything, I want you to realize we live in a generation to where everything goes. Everything is tolerated. Nobody wants to press on. Nobody wants to drive for anything anymore. No one has that internal motivation to get something spiritually anymore. My friends, I remember back in the 90s and 80s when we used to have all-night prayer services. Where has that gone? I'm not talking about let's have an all-night prayer service. I'm talking about we need to start seeking God again. Getting on our knees and serving and seeking and worshiping until something happens. Not just praying on a whim and wishing for the best. Seek God. Press. It's time to start serving with excellence again. The generation before us experienced more of a move of God than we do, than our generation does, because they sought Him. Seekers today, Christians today, do not seek God nearly as much as we used to. Now, I'll amen myself on that, because that's truth. That's the truth. I remember coming into services, we didn't have a three-day revival. Let's have a three-day revival. We had 2 3-week revivals. Why? Because you came in there and you were excited. You were ready to worship. You were ready to praise. You were ready to listen to the man or the woman of God that was giving the message. And when we came in there, we walked out the door ready to change our lives, ready to change the lives of the people that are in our heart, that were in our lives. We were ready to make a difference. Today, our generation, the church world today, is going through the motions. Maybe I'm breaking something new to you today, but I think you already know it. We're going through the motions. We want the power of God without seeking His presence. And that's impossible. If you want to experience God's power in your life, you must seek His presence. The Bible says, He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. My friends, the only way that you can get in a shadow of something is to have close proximity to it. Close proximity to where it becomes uncomfortable to be around sin. To where it becomes uncomfortable to be around the world. To where it becomes uncomfortable to stay in a fleshly mentality. Are you uncomfortable this morning? Or have you settled with the status quo? Does the Word of God stir you anymore? Or are you ready to just live the mediocre lifestyle? My friends, I don't expect the place to to be shouting this morning. I expect us all to take a step back and reflect. Where are you? Where are you? This is hitting me harder than it's hitting you. Because I know that I need to change. I know that I need to get better. I know that I need to press forward. Are you challenged? Are you pressing? Thank God for Joseph. Thank God for Daniel. I wonder if somebody in your life this morning is saying, thank God for you, that you set that example. Are you setting that example for your children? Are you setting that example for your family? Are you setting that example for your church? Or have you regressed to the point to where you don't know where you stand anymore? My friends, if you are at that point, it is time for you and me to hit this altar. It's time that we start seeking God like we used to. So I'm going to give you six things this morning to better serve God with excellence. Are you ready for these? Somebody say, I'm ready. Number one, stop wasting time. You know how much time that we waste by giving away our tea? And what I mean by that is T-E-A, time, energy, and attention. John Maxwell said there was four levels of relationships, and most of us live on the surface level. We give all of our attention and all of our time and all of our commitment and all of who we are, all of our energy, to relationships that simply do not matter. That person that cuts you off in line at the store, that person that got in front of you in that traffic jam, we give all of our attention and commitment and energy to them. And then we get home to our family, our wife and our kids, and we don't pay them a bit of attention. Something has to change. We give all of our energy towards the things of this world, and we have no time for God anymore. My friend, something has to change. Manage your time. If you're waiting for the right time to read your Bible, you're not going to find it. Because you have to make time. Manage your energy. Where are you spending your energy? On people that you have no control over? Or are you worried about re-energizing yourself through His Word? My friends, we must seek deeper, more secure relationships with God. Not be separated from Him because of meaningless routines that we go through. Number two, be dedicated. Are you dedicated this morning? Are you dedicated to excellence in Him? When you walk into a church building, when you walk into a room, when you walk into work, when you walk into your house, does the glory of God shine on your face? Folks, that is not something that we put out there as this unreachable goal. That is something that we can be dedicated and committed to daily, to where God, people see God in be dedicated. Serve with purpose. James chapter 1, verse 6 and 8 says, he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. My friends, serve with a single-minded purpose. Your purpose on this planet is to praise him and to get others to praise him as well. To reach others, to reach the lost. But we get so easily distracted because we try to do everything when we really should be concentrating on serving him. Number four, be led by the Spirit. Yes, you have to plan. Yes, you have to expect, but you also must be flexible to listen to what he has to say. Are you being led by his Spirit this morning? Number five, separate from the world. Many of you know who Oral Roberts was. He was quoted as saying this: if we demand excellence out of our students at Oral Roberts University, then we have to live excellence in front of them. How can you expect something out of people when you're not giving that out of yourself? Leaders fall because people don't see them committed to the same expectations that they have from the people around them. I want to be a leader. I want to be a minister. I want to be a God seeker first. I want to make sure that I'm following Christ. Because the Bible says, Paul said, follow me even as I follow Christ. Number six, look to the Word of God. These examples, these pillars of faith that we find in Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews 11 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things that are not seen. Hebrews 11, 6 says that we must come to him diligently and seek him. Faith comes through that. Are you looking to his word? And number seven, spend time with God through worship, fasting, through praise. We must be committed again to a life of excellence. Now this morning, my friends, I would challenge you that wherever you are in this life, wherever you are in your spirituality, make sure that you're serving with excellence. Hannah, I'm going to ask you to come on up to the piano. And I know that we have some things that we need to distribute. We'll do that in just a moment. But I want to give everyone a time to reflect. To reflect on where you are currently in your spiritual walk. I told you, my friends, that this may not be a shout in the house message because it's something that challenges us. It's something that should be tugging on your heart even now that I speak, as I speak. My question for you this morning is, are you living in a number three Christian lifestyle? In other words, are you stuck in the middle? Are you living in mediocrity with your walk with God? Or are you living, pressing forward to that number five, trying to reach that new level with God, trying to develop that relationship that you should have with him so that we can show others how we're supposed to live and how we're supposed to walk? Thank God for Joseph. Thank God for Daniel. I want my little girl to say, thank God that Daddy showed me how I'm supposed to live my life. I want my wife and my family to say, thank God for Jason, because he showed me what it meant to serve with excellence. I want people around me to know that I wasn't going through the motions. I wasn't saying what you wanted to hear. But I was living my life holy and acceptable to Him. This morning I challenge you, get out of that status quo mentality. That thing that has plagued the church for decades is trying to plague Christians today. Get rid of those weights. Serve Him with excellence, that we may seek Him, that we may show His love through our lifestyles. This morning, I want to ask you to stand. I ask you to bow your heads. I do this just a little bit different than Pastor Billy does, but that's okay. I want you to close your eyes and bow your heads as we're all standing here meditating on this morning. I don't want you to raise your hand. I don't want you to respond by saying anything or raising your hand. I just want you to ask this question in your heart. First of all, if you're not a believer here this morning, you need to get right with God. And you need to ask Him to come into your life this morning. And there's folks here this morning that's willing to pray with you. But I'm talking to believers specifically right now. How many of us are saying, could say, we're living with the spirit of excellence all the time? If you could say that this morning, that's awesome. That's awesome. But how many of us could say, you know what? I've been living my life in that area, that comfort zone, that mediocrity level, that status quo level, subpar, average. I have not been living to the standard that God has set for me to live. If that's you this morning, I'm going to invite you to come down and pray. Now, again, you can come and pray about whatever need that you may have. Maybe you have someone in your